Hi everyone, in this video we're going to take a closer look at amiodarone. Now, if I were to ask one of my new paramedic students, I go, well, what does amiodarone do? They go, well, it's an antiarrhythmic. Well, that's its classification of drug, true, but what does it do? And they'll go, well, we use it for VFib. Well, that's what it's for, but what does it do? Antiarrhythmics are classified based on their mechanism of action, specifically how they impact the cardiac action potential of the cell. Now, there's a few different classifications of antiarrhythmics. Class 1 antiarrhythmics are sodium channel blockers, and this would be lidocaine, they're class 1 antiarrhythmics. Class 2, beta blockers, metoprolol, and most drugs really ending in LOL. So if you see a drug that ends in LOL, it's probably a beta blocker, but not all of them. So if you see LOL, you can go, hey, I wonder if that's a beta blocker. Look it up and go, yep, it's a beta blocker. Class 3 antiarrhythmics are potassium channel inhibitors, and that's where amiodarone lives. Not exclusively, but amiodarone is a class 3 antiarrhythmic, and that puts it in the potassium channel inhibitor family. Class 4 antiarrhythmics are calcium channel inhibitors, and then there's a class 5, which is kind of like the stepchild of antiarrhythmics. It doesn't really fit in any other category. Adenosine would be in that. Atropine might fall into that. So those are the classifications. Now, as it pertains to amiodarone, amiodarone is a complex drug. Now, when I'm thinking about amiodarone, its classification, kind of reminds me of a bag of dog food. Right? In a bag of dog food, whatever ingredient is most abundant appears first in the list of ingredients, but there's still other stuff in the dog food. Now, same thing with amiodarone. It's classified as a class 3 potassium channel inhibitor, but there's other stuff in it. Additional properties of amiodarone include calcium channel blockers, beta blocker properties, sodium channel blocker properties, so it really impacts all this area of the action potential of the cardiac cell. And so it's a very complex drug. Now, all antiarrhythmics work by suppressing cardiac cell function, so it's suppressing the function of the heart. Therefore, all antiarrhythmics can cause bradycardia. They can cause hypotension. And when you're looking at the exact mechanism of action of the drug and you know that, you can anticipate both the effects of the drug and the negative side effects of the drug. So that's what amiodarone is. So what do we use amiodarone for in ACLS? Well, the ILCOR and AHA recommendations, we use amiodarone for ventricular arrhythmias, VTAC, VFib. Now, for pulseless VTAC and ventricular fibrillation, starting dose, 300 milligrams, IV push. Now, amiodarone often comes supplied 150 milligrams in 3 cc's. So to give that 300 milligram bump, you're going to need 2 vials and at least a 6cc syringe. Now, what's our treatment difference between pulseless VTAC and ventricular fibrillation? Nothing. They are always both treated the same. So a pulseless VTAC is the same as VFib. Now, we can also use amiodarone to treat a stable ventricular tachycardia. And when we're talking about stable, we're talking about hemodynamic stability. And I've seen this. I've had a patient who was alert, conscious, had a little fluttering in the chest, but their blood pressure was fine. They did not suffer from any altered mental status, and they were truly in VTAC. Okay, now the rule is always, we don't treat rhythms, we treat patients that have rhythms. Kind of with the exception of VTAC. VTAC we're going to treat regardless of whether the patient's stable or unstable, because VTAC, ventricular tachycardia, left unrecognized and untreated will ultimately at some point deteriorate into ventricular fibrillation. So we're always going to treat VTAC. Now, for stable VTAC, hemodynamically stable VTAC, the dosing of amiodarone is 150 milligrams over 10 minutes. Now, how are we actually going to give that in the field, right? What's the nuts and bolts of this? Well, always follow your local protocols, but they suggest taking 150 milligrams of amiodarone, that 3cc vial, injecting into a 100 ml bag of D5W, spike it with 60 drop tubing, and administer that over 10 minutes. And we always use 60 drop tubing just to make sure we don't just dump it right into the patient. Now, if you watch my video on calculating drip rates, and I have 100 ml bag of D5W and 60 drop tubing over 10 minutes, my drip rate comes out to 600 drops per minute. How are you gonna count that? You can't. So what do? Here's one technique, and again, follow your protocols, but if you start the amio drip with 60 drop tubing, you'll see a stream. Throttle that back, use your roller clamp and throttle it back just till you see the drip starting to form, and that should get you right around 10 minutes. Now play with it. Go get a bag of 100 D5W and some 60 drop tubing and play with it and time it, and you'll see that it's gonna be pretty close to 10 minutes. If you don't have an IV pump and you're in the field, that's as close as you're gonna get. Another method you might want to use is I have this 10cc syringe of saline. Find these all over the hospital. You're tripping over these things. I could take and waste 3cc's of this. Draw up my 3cc's of 150 milligrams of amiodarone and then administer 1cc per minute. Another option. Now remember, all antiarrhythmics work by suppressing cardiac function, but they all operate a little differently, their mechanism of action, to include the half-life of the drugs. For example, lidocaine has a half-life of about 1.5 to 2 hours, as opposed to amiodarone, which has a half-life of 40 days and 40 nights, over a month. So when you give this drug, it's not going anywhere anytime soon. So there is a huge difference in the antiarrhythmics that we're giving our patient. Again, they all cause cardiac suppression, so be alert for changes in their mental status, blood pressure, the development of bradycardia, any changes in your patient that you're going to detect through a constant reassessment of that patient. So, this has been a quick review of amiodarone. I'm Mark. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video.